Podcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Good afternoon. It's Thursday, July 19th, 2018, and this is one of our Let's Opinionate shows, and we have Veronica and Gina here from dogbiz. So who is that? That's one of the things we're going to be talking about today. And I've obviously got Louise, one of my cohort here, and Rebecca's here in the background, and Veronica and Gina are both on in the background. Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Hi, Nikki. How are you?
Hi. So I think before we do anything, let's just talk about dogbiz so that everybody who's listening to this, whether it be live or in the future, actually knows who is on here, because we've had a name change recently, haven't we?
We have. Yeah. You probably know us better as Dog Tech.
So that's a really good place to start, isn't it? So why the rebrand? What was the motivating factor behind the rebrand?
You mean besides it was past time?
That's right.
That was it. Just past time. Just okay.
No. Veronica.
Yeah, so when we started 15 years ago, the tech actually stood for Training Education Center. And we were Dog Training Education Center, and we had this business plan that included supporting people in their businesses, but we also had thought we would be doing a lot of education, a lot of continuing education and seminars and workshops and things like that for dog trainers. And so we had this sort of more comprehensive notion, and that name made a lot of sense. Within a couple of years, we had really narrowed focus. We were doing very little of the continuing education stuff, because around that time, lots of other people started doing that, and they were doing it really well. And we realized that the demand and the need for the business support side of things was even bigger than we'd thought. And so we kind of narrowed and said, okay, let's really put our energy into that. And at the time we thought, well, this name doesn't really work anymore. And so we just dropped the Training Education Center, but we stayed Dog Tech. And for years and years, we thought, oh, we should have just changed then. the amount of time people have thought that we're veterinarians or that we were software builders or whatnot. And we just kind of kept going. And then reflecting on this big milestone of our 15th anniversary, and we were planning the big new website build that we just launched a couple of months ago, and we just kind of had this conversation about if not now, when? And it doesn't get any easier to do it, so we decided it was time, in terms of sort of reflecting and looking at the next 15 years and what we want to do to support dog professionals and really help them have satisfying, successful careers. We just thought, it makes more sense to call ourselves what we are.
I'm kind of laughing in the background here, because when you said what the tech stood for, I thought, well, that makes sense, but I never knew that. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah, I know. It's funny. I mean, there are a few people who were with, and back then we were actually facility based. When we first opened, yeah, we had a classroom facility and the whole thing, and there's still clients and colleagues and stuff who are with us from way back then, few people remember what that originally was, but yeah, it's probably been a good 13 years since we've use that part of our name.
Yeah, it's really interesting. It actually reminded me of something I saw on social media last week, and you guys might have seen it, but it made me laugh in the same way. You know the game tag that children play? Does anybody know what tag actually stands for?
No.
It stands for touch and go. And now how come we all played this game since we're about 4 years of age and no one ever said what does tag stand for?
Huh. How interesting.
Isn't that interesting? And I kind of laughed as soon as I heard the tech, because I thought, wow, that reminds me of the tag I saw on social media. And it's interesting, isn't it, how the name has a purpose, yet people don't necessarily know the purpose, but the name's still effective, or ineffective, as the case might be in some cases.
Yeah, we really wanted a name that reflected the fact that we really are focused on business, the business aspect, and partly, for what Veronica said, which is there were other people doing great things around teaching training at the time, and partly just because we're really lazy dog trainers, and we feel like it's true. We feel like we can help more dogs by keeping dog professionals in the business. So that was kind of our easy way out.
That's really interesting. Yeah, and it's funny because I bet a lot of people look at that logo and don't actually cognitively recognize that the second word has changed from tech to biz because they just see the six letters and the blue graphic in the middle.
Yeah, we have a bet going about whether or not people would even notice that we changed.
Right. Yeah, we felt really lucky that way too. You know, it made the rebranding so simple. I mean, like, well, we'll just, you know, swap these three letters out. Nothing has to visually change, and yeah so that definitely made things a bit simpler.
And it's interesting because if you look at the screen that's on now, and this says Barks Podcast, because in the last couple of months we recognized that Barks from the Guild and our news from the Guild and our blogs from the Guild, and then we had PPG World Services that was our podcast, and we thought, well, if we're building this brand new platform for Barks to try and disseminate the magazine to a wider audience, let's put any of our communication under that same branding under Barks. So we've rebranded PPG World Services as Barks Podcasts, so that it all all collectively comes under the same branding. And when you put those logos together, they all look the same. So, and I, you know, when I made that decision, for me, there was no looking back because I didn't think PPG World Services resonated with people. I thought the platform it was on was ugly. And it just made a lot of sense given that Barks had a much wider platform. So I personally love change. I think it's important that businesses keep evolving. And I think a lot of people don't do it enough, whether it's updating a website monthly or just looking at what they're offering in terms of services. And you sort of talk to them and they're doing the same thing now they were doing 10 years ago. Well, we all know the marketplace has changed significantly. So, I'm a creature of change. I'm one of those few people that says, yeah, let's change it, bring it on, rather than, oh, do we have to change it?
But you're right when it comes to any dog professional business. Change and evolution is not, it's normal and it's essential. And it's so interesting when you talk with people who are just getting started, you know, we always tell them, you know, let's wait till we talk in a year, your business will look completely different. And they're like, oh, no, I know exactly what I want to do. And yeah. Okay. But in a year, it will look different because you will react to the market, you'll react to what you enjoy doing, you'll react to your strengths. And being flexible is important.
Absolutely. And I think, and it goes hand in hand with asking small business owners. I was talking to someone the other day and I was asking them, they're wanting to make a very fundamental decision about closing down a segment of services. And I said, well, you know, the first question you have to ask yourself, unless you're a relaxed millionaire, is what are these services contributing in terms of income? And they couldn't answer that question. I said, well, the first thing you need to do is go and look at that, because that might significantly change your opinion in terms of closing those services down.
Right.
You know, and I think, and often trainers will say, well, my group class is bringing all the money. And when you actually look at it and look at the expenses attached to that, it's often not the case at all. So sometimes, right. Yeah. So sometimes those changes should be financially driven, because I've seen businesses where they've got, you know, pet sitting services, boarding services, daycare services, dog training, and then maybe agility and dog sports. And all their focus is put on the dog sports. And actually the dog sports is losing money and draining the profit away from the other areas of their business.
I often find that happens. It's the service that keeps you the busiest that you assume is making the most money. And that's rarely true. That's just rarely true. But you're right, looking at the bottom line.
Oh, I was talking to somebody that was getting overwhelmed with contractors and was sort of at a point in their life where they think they want to do other things in terms of start a family, blah, 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 blah. And they said, but it brings in the most income. When we looked at it, I said, yeah, but it's not making any money because you're paying them 70% commission. You've got an overhead on the building. You would actually be more profitable and less busy and with less hassle if you just didn't have contractors.
Right.
Yeah, it's such an interesting thing. You know, when we're working with clients, right, you know, looking at, you know, first of all, recognizing, as you say, that a lot of times the impression of the numbers is not the same as the actual numbers, and having to take a look at that, and then trying to balance that too with longevity, emotional longevity. You know, what do you most enjoy doing? Where do you feel you're having your biggest impact? And sort of trying to find that sweet spot. And I think another thing you said that's so important too is, what is the right size business? Because I think sometimes people build something that's much larger and it has all these movable parts, and then there's a point comes where you're not enjoying having to keep track of all of those movable parts. And so we do see that a lot, where you know, that part of the change is about scaling back to whatever the core is, the core that suits your mission most and that is going to take best financial care of you, you're kind of finding, you know, where that balance is. Because I think one of the other things that's really fantastic about change, if you set the fear down, is that it's tremendously reinvigorating. I mean, yeah, I mean, for Gina and I, it feels, and before I started Dog Tech, I don't think I'd done anything for more than 3 years, you know? And here we are 15 years in, and I am actively looking forward to the next 15. And part of that, I think, is because we're always creating and innovating and changing, and it keeps things so exciting, you know, to just not get to that place where it's same old all the time.
You know, it's so funny you said that, because I was having this very conversation with one of our board members yesterday, because prior to PPP, I was a business executive that went into properties, spent 2 years there. The goal was to revitalize and put them back into profitability and then move on to the next one. And I love that, because it took me all over the world, and I hated being in the same place for more than 18 months. And by the time 18 months came, I was like, got to get out of here. I was looking at PPG, I thought, my God, this is our seventh year, and I'm still not home. Yeah. There's so much going on with it. I mean, and it made me laugh when you mentioned about being lazy, because I'm the laziest person in the world, period, which is why I think I'm very efficient, because I would much rather have lots and lots of people involved and manage and delegate than actually do the work myself.
I'm with you.
When I say do the work, obviously I do work, and I think I work really hard, but I know some people that just have no interest at all. They're quite happy with a niche of their mission, what they want to do, and making a good living without having the hassle of other people. I enjoy the hassle of other people. I complain about it all the time, but I also enjoy it. And I said that for the benefit of Louise and Rebecca.
Much appreciated, Nikki.
But, you know, knowing that is really key to knowing how to best grow your business in the future. Knowing if you're a delegator or not, really, if you're thinking about, you know, where do I want my business to be in 5 or 10 years, which I hope everyone sits down and thinks about, you know, at some point, knowing that key piece of information will, for a dog professional, will really dictate what you do in the future.
Yeah, and Gina, do you find when you talk to people that they're hesitant to say, it's almost like it's that they shouldn't be saying this when they say, but I don't want to have any employees? I find they're almost apologizing. It's like, no, it's your business. You can do whatever you want with it.
Yeah, it's almost like there's some fear that they can't have a robust, successful business if they don't have employees. And that's myth. That's just not true.
Right, yeah. Or they feel that to be perceived as a professional or a business owner, they have to have a cadre of employees or contractors. And I always use Andrew Lloyd Webber, his production company in England, Phantom of the Opera. I mean, I remember studying as part of business school, studying several profit and loss statements and having to identify what industry they were attached to. And I remember nobody in my class could get his, because it brought in millions of dollars, but there were 3 people on the payroll.
Wow.
Nobody could figure that out. And that for me is a really good model. I mean, what a great business when there's only 3 of you and you're bringing in millions and millions of dollars. You don't have to have a cadre of hundreds of employees to run a successful business. I mean, you just don't.
No, I absolutely agree. And in fact, and that's one of the things I talk with clients right off the bat about, which is just, you know, if the thought of employees makes you break out in hives, you shouldn't have them. Like if you're, even before you have them, you're already worried about how will I hire them and how will I deal with them? That's probably not for you. Don't do it. Because you know, you either love supervising or you don't.
Yeah. I tend to dig a little bit deeper as well when someone says no, because sometimes I find, and I'd be interested to see if you guys do too, I find that often the reluctance is not about the management or the delegation or having to put operational systems in place. It's the fear of having to wrangle with potential employment in terms of documentation, payroll, appropriate taxes. And when they realize that there's actually a very simple solution for that, which can be done through QuickBooks or another payroll service, it sort of opens up a different framework for thinking about having employees.
And sometimes it's because they've not had them before and they don't know. It's funny, we're positive reinforcement trainers. And so the thought of dealing with an employee issue that's maybe not a comfortable one can be really scary if you've never had to do it. Like, I don't want to have to boss anyone around, kind of that attitude. And sometimes it's just a matter of gaining some skill sets in how to be a positive leader.
Absolutely. And I think that's a really good word, skill set, because it's not something that is natural for a lot of people. And there are ways that you can learn to have, you know, honest conversations without it being, you know, conflictive and unpleasant. And there are ways to be able to communicate and give feedback, again, you know, remaining with positive dialogue. And I think a lot of people automatically think the minute you have to go into an evaluation or a review or some kind of workplace discussion that it's going to be unpleasant. And that doesn't have to be the case at all. But yeah, it's about a skill set, isn't it? And if you haven't had it in your previous life, then it makes it difficult.
Right.
I find as well that a lot of people have that same fear of financials. They sort of fear to the point where they put their head in the sand. Not is a good way of dealing with them.
There is nothing more funny to me than the avoidance tactics that people will take when it comes to money and looking at money or not, as the case may be.
I mean, one of the things I love about all of my work is financial numbers for me they tell a really good operational story. I mean, you can extract so much more information from them than just about financial performance.
To me, financials that aren't going the way you want they're the challenge. They're the training task, right? Like, where are we? Where do we want to be? What information can we gather for them? Because if you understand your financial picture, then the way out is much clearer than if you just put your head in the sand and hope it gets better. That doesn't feel like much of a strategy.
Yeah.
I will say, you know, I think for people who are listening, who are like, oh yeah, no, that's just so uncomfortable. And you know, for whatever it's worth, you know, that kind of energy around numbers and excitement about them and investment in them is something that you can achieve, even if it's the sort of thing that generally, you know, just makes your blood curdle. And I say that because I, you know, as Gina knows, I mean, we balance each other well. And I am, you know, sort of by nature, one of those number fear people. I don't want anything to do with it. I don't want to look at it. It makes me nervous. I don't want to deal. Like, I enjoy the process of generating revenue, of making money, because I feel like when I'm making money, it means that I'm making a difference.
Right.
You know, that we're out there, you know, really having a positive impact in positive reinforcement dog pose lives, which means that they're out there helping that many more dogs. And that gets me really excited. But I don't actually want to deal with the numbers. And I always felt, you know, just kind of scared and queasy. And I remember, you know, early on, Gina saying, we really should have a budget. I'm like, oh God, can we talk about something else? Yeah, I don't want to look at that. But if that's where you're sitting now, I just want you to know that you can absolutely overcome it. You know, that the fear goes away once you start to do it. And especially if you've got somebody, you know, who's adept at it, who can guide you and just, you know, sort of get you through the really scary first parts of starting to look at something that you've, you know, kept under the rug for a long time. I think that's the hardest part, is just, you know, when you've gone a really long time without addressing something that you kind of know you should, it's just like the more time that passes, the harder it is to take the first step. And I think, you know, in those kinds of situations, sometimes just finding somebody who can walk with you through those first steps and just, you know, you don't have to do it by yourself. And I, you know, just passing on that message that it really is possible to overcome, you know, those kinds of fears.
Nikki, like you said, finding someone who can help you see the story that's there in the numbers.
Yeah. I mean, to a lot of people, not understanding just the difference between a current asset versus a long-term asset, or how that asset impacts the P&L statement. And it's, you know, I often use sort of examples, like, you know, take people through examples like starting a bicycle shop, and, you know, you're going to buy your inventory and you're going to sell your inventory, and how that inventory then becomes cash. And I think when people sort of see how that money moves and what it enables you to do, it can become really empowering.
Yeah.
Your business. And ultimately being able to make business decisions that are proactive, you know, there's no point in, and I always talk about some of the shoebox accounting, which a lot of people do. They throw everything in a shoebox and once a year they go throw it at the bookkeeper who charges them a fortune because they have to do all the work and then do your taxes rather than you spending an hour a month doing your own bookkeeping and then just having someone do your taxes. And then the accountant says, well, you actually lost $4,000 last year. Oh, did I? Well, if you have a rudimentary understanding of bookkeeping and you're managing your own accounting, you see that before it happens. Therefore, you can put preventative measures in place or you can mitigate by putting special offers out or some sort of seasonal discounts or packages or however you choose to do it. And you can't separate your marketing from your finances. I mean, they just interrelate. Be effective at one, you've got to be somewhat okay at the other. So I think it's really important.
And I think, you know, even if, you know, for listeners who, you know, choose to not do the actual bookkeeping work and all that themselves, which I think there's something to be said for too, just in terms of, especially for people who are, you know, a one woman show or one guy show running their businesses, to say, hey, I'm going to, you know, contract some of this out so that I can, you know, really sink my time into the things that I do well. I think that's perfectly okay. But then you've got to take the time to, you know, to sit down with the numbers that are generated for you to just, you know, and use those to make decisions and that sort of thing. And it kind of, you know, it's interesting too, because we were talking about like employees and contractors and things like that. And just thinking about, you know, for dog pros who just really want to be a one dog pro show, it doesn't mean that you can't grow, right? There are a lot of ways to grow a single person business, and I think, yeah, that's important to know too. It doesn't necessarily, I mean, you know, sure there are certain ways in which you know you're limited, but not to the extent that I think people often think.
Right. No, absolutely. And I completely agree with you on the outsourcing. With anyone that I talk to, especially our dogsmiths, I do encourage them through our training to learn about the financials, because then it enables them to ask intellectual questions of their bookkeepers and like all professions. But I do think that absolutely, you know, there's nothing wrong with having somebody else do it for you as long as you do take that time to understand it. Otherwise, you're not really delegating. You're abdicating it, aren't you? It's just another.
Right. That's a great distinction.
A tactic to not have to look at them is just to farm it out to somebody else.
True.
Yeah. Obviously, something else I was going to throw in then, but I lost it. It was based on the last comment that you made about, the one man show. Yeah, I remember going on a course many, many, many years ago with a business consultant in London, and this is like 30 years ago, and I remember the first question he asked, and I always think this is a really important question for us all to ask in terms of our businesses, is what's your plan in terms of how you want to exit this business? Are you relying on this business to be something that you can sell as your retirement income? Or is this something that you want to do just to enjoy from, but you're not relying on it for your income? Are you planning on at some point selling the business or bringing other people in? Because a lot of people, and this is quite pertinent with lawyers and doctors and sort of highly professional people that don't necessarily have a cadre of employees or have a bricks and mortar, but they are sort of, you know, service professionals. They work for 30 or 40 years. They build up what they believe is a very, very profitable business. And when they go to sell it, a business broker will value it as only 1x net profit because they really don't have anything to sell other than a client list.
Right.
Because if you're not there, then the business in effect doesn't, you know, is not maintained. So I always like to sort of ask people, what's your plan? Because if your plan is to sell this at some point, build it and sell it, then you've got to start thinking about structuring it in 5 years, 10 years, or even from now, so that you have something that you can sell. And that might mean bringing in an operations manager 2 or 3 years before you sell, so that when you do sell, you have a structured business that somebody else can buy and run with, rather than, okay, thank you for the client list, but there isn't really very much else there. I don't know what your thoughts are on that.
Yeah, it's interesting. People, especially in, I think, the dog industry, sometimes you just kind of fall into it. You don't have that end game in mind. And it is important. It's important to have the end game. It's also important to have a plan for growth. So often when we're working with newer clients, they can't even imagine having enough work, let alone having too much work. And one of the first things I want to do with them right away is, you know, what does the business look like now? What does it look like at capacity? You know, what is the plan for growth? And like you said, and what is the end game? Really helping people to come up with a plan, because there's nothing more uncomfortable than going from 0 to 60 and having not planned for it. And suddenly there's business everywhere and you've got no time and you're stressed. And it, business takes planning from start to finish. And knowing the end game helps you with the intermediate steps for sure.
Right. And another mistake that I've seen a lot of, and this isn't just in when I used to do some business consulting, but this is also having spent several years buying businesses, is when you go to buy a business and it's valued, let's say it's valued at 100,000 for our argument, because the net profit's 40,000, 50,000. And the business owner tells you, well, you know, I actually brought in another $20,000 last year, but it was all cash. And it's like, well, sorry, that doesn't enter into the valuation because it's not.
Right, that doesn't count. Right.
Yeah. And I know a lot of small business owners that will do that. They won't put cash through the books and they think, great, I'm not paying the tax. But not, well, number one, it's illegal. But as importantly, when you come to want to sell that business, you can't prove that the business is worth, because there's no record of the income the business has generated. So, you know, I think things like that, which people don't tend to think about, but are really important, just making sure that you operate the business, you know, properly, ethically, if the end game, well, I mean, that should be obviously the goal with any business, but particularly if you want, at some point, you're building a business to sell and generate some retirement income from.
Yeah, that it needs to show a profit.
Yeah.
if you want to be able to sell, right? That you see the same mistake with over-reporting expenses. I see that with dog pros a lot, where they're, you know, well, the income didn't look very high, but it paid for all my agility for a year. Well, that's not, you know, it looks like a big expense on the books.
Yeah. Well, and, you know, I remember back in 2005 or 6, we looked at a very large boarding kennel and dog training center in North Carolina to purchase it. And we drove all the way over there. It was a really nice facility. Came on like 20 acres with a really nice house. And we, first of all, he didn't have a profit and loss statement. He had nothing. And we were there with a professional business broker. And so I said, okay, where are all your receipts? So I spent 2 days sitting at his desk with a big calculator and Excel going through every single receipt to show what the business had brought in. And he told me sort of by whispering that 50% of his income he put in his back pocket and didn't go through the business. And I said, well, you know, sorry, I don't know you. I don't, you know, trust and verify it. You can't show that. So we didn't buy the business, which was a shame. That business is still for sale now today.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And I follow it regularly and it makes me chuckle, because I said to Rick, I bet after this, he'll go away, think about it, start putting everything into a proper bookkeeping system, start putting cash with the books, because technically speaking, in 3 years, he'd have a very profitable business to sell.
Right.
Most people buying businesses only look at the last 3 years of income. That's what most banks want if they're going to be lending money to you. And I spoke to the broker a couple of years ago. She said, no, he still can't sell it. He expects somebody to buy it on trust. Well, no. Do that.
No.
Yeah. So I just think it's interesting how if we sort of do take shortcuts sometimes in our business, we don't realize what the unintended consequences of those are until the day comes when maybe you want to go to a bank and get a loan so you could buy a facility, or you want to build a facility, or you want to sort of leverage something, and you realize you can't because you can't show financials that prove that your business is viable.
And part of putting those good policies and practices in place right from the very beginning means that when you are ready to grow the business, you're ready for whatever direction it may take. We talked earlier about flexibility and change. Well, the best way to be ready and to be flexible and ready for change is to have good business practices in place from day one.
Right.
And not, because, man, when you start a business, you just cannot imagine where you'll be in 5 years. You think you can, and you head that direction, but opportunities come up or challenges come up, and you're going to take some detours along the way. And if you want to be ready for those detours, then have good practices in place right from the beginning so that you're flexible to make those changes when you need to.
Absolutely, absolutely. How do you feel that as an industry we are a little bit behind in terms of making it easy for our customers to sign up for services? Because I still get a little bit of gas, and maybe this is me just being a bit of an ass. I get a bit of a gas when I go to websites, and to sign up for a class, you've got to download and fill out an 8-page form. And you just think, my God, how many people are actually going to do that rather than just click a button, fill out a few lines and pay? And then it says, then you've got to mail me a check. And I'm just like, wow, we're really not, from a marketing perspective, you know, our pricing and how we position our business and how easy we make it for clients to pay us is a key part of our marketing. And we don't seem to make it easy for clients to find our services, book our services, and pay for our services. Do you think that's, if we were going to generalize, which I hate to do, but if we were going to generalize, do you think that's a common opportunity for us all to get better at selling ourselves and selling our services?
Absolutely. I think the issue around, you know, convenience of class signups and things like that, I do think it has improved a lot over the 15 years that we've been doing this, because I remember in the beginning, if you wanted, you know, online registration for classes, you kind of had to have that custom built for, you know, for your website. Whereas now there are so many plugins and you know, it's just so easy to do that, and so inexpensive to do it. And so I do see a lot of improvement, but I am also surprised by, I was just looking at a website yesterday where, you know, there's no automated registration for classes, and he was making a recommendation about that. And yeah, I think part of it is, I think we're still in a large way approaching this as a cottage industry as opposed to a professional one. And I think a lot of that practice is just simply because I think so many people who own businesses in the dog world do so out of necessity rather than goal. And, you know, I say this all the time. I mean, you know, the vast majority of positive reinforcement dog trainers I know who own businesses, they own businesses because if you want to make a living as a dog trainer, you have to own a business. I mean, there just aren't that many jobs for dog trainers. And so they come into the industry and the work with a you know, it's really about altruism, you know, this really altruistic mindset about wanting to help dogs, not with an entrepreneurial mindset. You mean, I know some dog professionals who've always wanted to own their own businesses, but it's not the majority of us. You know, I mean, I didn't grow up thinking that I would be a business owner. That wasn't an original drive for me. But you get into this industry and you realize, oh yeah, you know, and then, you know, for us, you know, Gina and I, you know, we were the rare dog trainers who had jobs. We were both working at the San Francisco SPCA. I was director of behavior and training there, and Gina was the rehab coordinator and also taught in the academy for dog trainers. And it was watching trainers graduate from that program and then end up going back to the previous careers and jobs they hated because they couldn't figure out how to make a business run that was the, you know, the original generator for us to create DogBiz. And I think that there's just so much, you know, focus on the training side of things, and the business side of things always gets that short shrift. And whether that translates as, you know, not putting the attention and time into making it easy for people to access services, or whether it translates into not keeping track of numbers, or whether it translates into avoiding marketing, or, you know, whatever it might be. You know, Gina and I were chatting yesterday, and she said something that I thought, yeah, it's just so perfect. You know, you've got to put as much time and energy into your business plan as you do into your training plans. And I think that's just it's a hard part, because it's not the part that comes naturally. It's not the part that is exciting. But one of the things that we find, and this was a big question mark for us when we started 15 years ago, was, so how much of these skill sets involved are innate, you know, the ability to, you know, become, you know, to sell something, and, you know, to be a good business person and all this, and how much of it, you know, can we teach this? I mean, how, you know, to what extent can we really help people, especially clients for whom the business side of things is just is just truly, truly profoundly uncomfortable. But, you know, the good news is 15 years later, you know, we can say with complete confidence that whoever you are, however you feel about business, whatever your, you know, the skill set is currently, whatever your comfort level is, it doesn't matter what your personality is, your temperament, all of that. These really are skill sets that can be developed. And what we find is that as the skill sets develop, the comfort develops. And so it really, really is possible to get good at the business side so that you can make the most use of the skills that you have on the training side.
I think you make a good point, Veronica, about the business side not getting much focus. And I think that's part of, that's at the heart of what Nikki's talking about. Nikki, I think that people have gotten better at making classes easier to sign up for because technology has made it easy. Where I still see like the long forms that you have to fill out and stuff, I still see that on the private consults or the private training work. And yep. I think part of the problem is trainers can't get out of their own way sometimes. First of all, they put a lot of pressure on themselves to the minute they walk in somebody's door to train the dog perfectly. Like they're afraid to take some time and get some history and figure out what they need to figure out, you know, at that first session. And so they feel like they need all this information before they go in because they forget that they're dog trainers, that if you put a trainer and a dog in a room for an hour, the trainer is going to figure out something to do with them. They just will. But they put a lot of pressure in, so they want all this information ahead of time because they want to make sure that they walk in and they have all of the answers on day one. And I think that that causes us to put up these roadblocks to making sales. The other thing I see with it is I see other trainers who will argue with me that say, well, it's a screening tool. I screen, if they won't fill out that consult form, then they won't do their homework. And I always say, show me the data that there's any correlation between me filling out your big long form and whether or not I train my dog.
That's so true. And you think about too, like the whole reason that people hire professionals is to have something done for them, right? I mean, people are busy. Dog training clients are busy. And so they're looking for a service that gets something done for them. And so, right, I mean, the idea that if they won't sit down and fill out a 6-page form, they're not going to be a good client, that's not necessarily the case. I mean, you know,
what it tells you is if they're like me, they don't like to write and they'll do anything to avoid it. It has nothing to do with whether or not I'll train my dog.
They're just busy. And I think we have to stop judging that. You know, I think a lot of trainers feel like, well, if a client won't take the time to fill out their form, then they're not serious about it. Or if, you know, and you know, this notion too, you know, Gina and I have for many, many, many years been, you know, really big proponents pushing this idea of dog trainers actually training dogs for people instead of this notion that we labor under that our job is to teach people to train their own dogs. You know, doctors don't teach people to administer their own chemo treatments, and lawyers don't teach you to go into court and argue your own case, and plumbers don't teach you how to fix your own leaks. I mean, people hire professionals to have something done for them. And I think there's this notion that people must not be good, dedicated dog guardians if they're hiring someone. But, you know, what's the percentage of people who homeschool their own children? Are only the people who homeschool their children good parents? I mean, we just have to get out of our own way and recognize that when somebody goes looking for a dog trainer, it's because they want something done. They want a problem solved. And it's our job to do that. And we need to kind of set down this notion that the only okay way to do that is forcing the client to do it. And then we're so frustrated and disappointed in the results and the compliance and all that sort of thing. And so just remember that whether it's about putting up roadblocks with big, long forms ahead of time, you know, anything like, you know, or insisting that people become junior dog trainers or what, it's really just about providing a service, and that is how you make the difference for the dogs. You know, when you change a dog's behavior, that changes the relationship between the client and the dog. I mean, that's the thing people, you know, the pushback that people have so much about that is, well, you know, but my job is to improve the relationship between the dog and the owner. And my answer is always, show me a faster way to do that than changing the dog's behavior. I mean, it just, you know, completely changes the owner's behavior in response. And so I think that's so important, and I love the point that, you know, Gina, that you're making about that initial consult. You know, you think about this whole notion that we have to go in there ready to start the training plan, as opposed to seeing the initial consult as the fact-finding mission to create the training plan with. I mean, we have to let that go, partly because it's so inconvenient and puts so much burden on the client to, you know, fill all this stuff out. But, you know, think about it in other industries too. You know, you go in to see a professional, whether it's a medical professional or a legal professional or accountant or whatnot, and that initial meeting is about, let's get to know you, let's get to know your goals and what issues are going on with you, and put a plan together. And so we don't need to feel the pressure that we put on ourselves as dog trainers to go into that first session with a solution and to be able to enact it. I mean, it's bad for business anyway, but it's also really bad for clients and dogs, because we don't set ourselves up. Our systems aren't set up to make sure that we are going to successfully sell and maximize the amount of time that is actually necessary to get the job done.
It was so funny. That reminds me of, I had to call an exterminator this week. They won't even do anything on the first appointment. Like, the first appointment is about figuring out your
There are bugs in my house.
Right. It's like, could you just make the ants go away? But, you know, but they wanted to make sure they knew just what, you know, what I needed and how to best keep the ants from coming back. Yeah, it's a lot of pressure that we put on ourselves. And it also, you know, when we're teaching people, not overwhelming them is really hard for trainers sometimes, because we have all this information and we want to share it all, and we forget what it's like to be the learner and have all that coming at you. So, you know, if you ask them to fill out 6 pages of information, you feel like you have to address it all when you walk in, they're not going to learn anything, because you're going to overwhelm them. So remembering that part of our job, whether it be signing up for our services or doing that consult or doing the training, is keeping it simple for people so that they can take the next step. It's breaking it down, just like we would a training plan for a dog, breaking the steps of the training process down into manageable, bite-sized pieces that people feel like they can accomplish. Because if I get a 6-page questionnaire and I'm nervous about what my dog is doing, I may just give up. I may decide it's too hard.
I personally believe that the way we do those first consults is why the attrition rate is so high in our industry. Because, you know, people, I ask people, well, talk me through your first lesson, and they've given out like 10 handouts to read. They've shown them 4 behaviors and they've done the intake form, thinking, oh my God, these people must be just like, oh my God, you've got to be a bloody rocket scientist to train a dog.
Right. You know, and when you bring that back to the topic of growth, right, of you know, how do you grow your business? There are a lot of different ways to grow your business, but one of them is to actually sell training. And I you know, so when people do what you're describing, Nikki, you know, when they fully overwhelm people and try to accomplish, and I think we just, you know, we have this horrible self-fulfilling cycle where we're so afraid we're not going to get asked back that we try to do everything up front, which means we do not get asked back. And one way to grow your business is to learn an initial consult model that actually sets you up for a successful package sale. Because then, rather than, you know, 1 or 2 or 3 sessions, you know, you're getting paid for 1 or 2 or 3 sessions per client, you get paid for much, much more. Plus, I think in terms of avoiding burnout, A, you're getting paid better. B, your efficacy is much higher. I mean, the case outcomes are so much more satisfying. So you stay in the game longer, which means you help more dogs over time. And that's one of the things we talk to our clients about a lot when they're nervous about, you know, changing that initial consult model, when they've got themselves so convinced that it's only valuable if they go in and do all the stuff in that first call, that you know, if, I mean, you know, a big part of helping people try something new is just stepping back and remembering the ultimate goal is to help as many dogs as much as possible. And that is usually what I find, you know, because change is hard for people. And especially when, I find that even when clients realize that it's not really working, there's that comfort in routine. And it's so uncomfortable to shake up something you've been doing and take a completely different approach to it. But when, you know, the motivation comes in wanting to help more dogs and to help more deeply. And then once you start, once you try it differently, it's so powerful to get that first big package sale, you know, to see a training plan all the way through to its conclusion and to see, you know, real change in the dog and a real change in the relationship between the dog and the client. That's just so powerful. We find that once clients try it once or twice, they don't turn back because it just makes such a difference. And
and the client gets successes because they're being taught properly and guided properly. So then their skin's in the game rather than, I think you get two kinds of clients. The ones that go, oh my goodness, I have no idea. I was going to have to read a thesis every night before you came, where you've been. And then they get overwhelmed, or you get the smart, savvy one that says, well, after one appointment, I've pretty much got everything I need to know. Thank you for the 25 handouts. I'm going to go train my own dog.
So, right. And neither of which are correct, probably. When I often talk with trainers,
getting new business because, you know, they're either leaving or doing it themselves.
And we're not really serving the client, because how many behavior problems or how many training tasks can you do in a single session? How many can you really accomplish in a single session? And if you're only selling one session, you wasted their time and money, in my opinion. And so it's not serving the dog. It's not serving the client. It's not serving your business. So, you know, what serves all three better is to have enough time to get the job done.
Absolutely.
And I think a big part of this is just moving past the guilt. I think because we do come at this from an altruistic standpoint, you know, we become dog trainers because we love them and we want to help them. And then we feel guilty about charging for it, and we feel like we should, you know, make it accessible to everyone. But the reality is that, and I hate this every day, but there are only so many hours in a day and there are only so many days in a week. You can't help them all anyway. So given that, let's help them really well and make a living doing it, because that's how you'll help more dogs, is that you'll still be doing this 10, 15, 20 years from now.
Absolutely. So what else can we talk about? Well, let's talk about dogbiz. Let's talk about some of the new things that you guys are developing or rolling out, or you have rolled out. Tell us about how you can help. What can you help? How can you help pet industry professionals to not become overwhelmed and have successful businesses, whether it's, you know, as a sole proprietor or a massive, massive conglomerate?
It has been a year of change, certainly for dog business, and it's well beyond just the business name. And some of you may have noticed the new website that just went up this month to address some of the things that you mentioned, which was making it easier to sign up for stuff and find stuff. But there are a couple other big projects Veronica might want to talk about too.
Well, just 2 days ago, our Dog Walking Academy, which is a professional program for dog walkers and also for people who would like to become dog walkers. We've been teaching that for 15 years throughout the US and in various other countries as well. And 2 days ago, it went online. And so now it is available from anywhere. So we're really, really excited about that. And that is, we've been doing web seminars and things like that for many, many, many years, but this is our first, real online course, and that is setting us up for our next big project called Dogbiz University, which is Gina's brainchild. So I'll let you chat a little bit about that one.
Well, this fall, the university will go online, and it is online learning, but it's all about business, the business of running a dog professional business. So there will be classes on marketing and budgeting and pretty much anything you need to know to run your business, whether you're a sole proprietor or you have lots of employees. And there will be courses that you can take individually, just one-offs, but there will also be some majors where you can decide, I want to get really good at marketing and take a series of classes to really educate you without going back to college. Just go to dogbiz.
Yeah, and a big part of the focus on this is that, so we do one-on-one consulting, business support, and work with clients all around the world, helping them to start businesses or grow them or solve problems and whatnot. And for us, our mission is to support positive reinforcement dog professionals, and by doing that, to help as many dogs as we can. And we love the consulting work, and it's just so powerful and just amazing to have that one-on-one relationship and to really support individual dog pros to reach their goals. And and we've got a wonderful team of consultants now, so that we're able to do that for more people. Our capacity is broader, but a big part of the idea that Gina brought to the table with dogbiz U was this idea of how can we have a broader impact? How can we make the expertise that we have to share and the support that we're so keen to share with people, how can we make that more easily accessible to more people? And so that was sort of the question that that generated the idea of this new program. So we're really excited about that. And as we were kind of reflecting on the first 15 years and then looking forward over the next 15, that was one of the big goals, is just, how do we have a broader impact? And so we're hoping that dogbiz U will help us do that.
Very exciting. Been a little busy. Yeah.
I'm really pleased for you guys. Good for you. So how can people contact you? What's the best way to get hold of you if they want to look at the university or the dog walking or some of the other great products that you've got on the website? How can they get to you?
Yeah, so the new website is dogbizsuccess.com.
And there are lots of demonstration videos and lots of great information there. If they have specific questions that the website doesn't answer, they can email info@dogbizsuccess.com.
Fabulous. So, how do you both have completely separate roles in the business? How have you structured that so that you can sort of tap in and leverage the things that you enjoy doing? Or is it more about sort of time or location? Or is it driven by skills and expertise?
Nikki, if it has to do with writing, we make Veronica do it.
And if it's video, that's Regina. we do, in terms of sort of the vision work and the direction work and generating ideas and prioritizing and things like that, that's a team effort. We just we have just a lot of fun kind of figuring out, what should we be doing and how should we do it and that sort of thing. And then, once we've got a project, then it's a matter of, okay, well, if the goal is this, what are the steps that are going, what's the plan, right? So we've got this idea for a university, or we want to take this flagship program online, or build the website, whatever it might be, then we just, we break it down into an action plan. What are the steps that need to be taken? And then we decide who in the company is taking which steps and by when, and then just kind of march our way through it and try to have as much fun as possible along the way.
For our team, it's really project driven. So sometimes it's by geography, sometimes it's by expertise, and sometimes it's by which one of us just has a particular interest to lead a given project. We've been really blessed for the first 15 years that we're able to do most of our projects together. Now that, this year, we've talked about this being a year of growth, now we're starting to spearhead things a little bit more separately, but we still get to work together on everything. But the lead role goes to just depends on the project.
Yeah, and then we've got a couple other core people on the team as well, which is just fantastic. Plus our team of consultants who are just amazing people, and they contribute a lot of wonderful ideas as well.
Excellent. So really what you're talking about is how people should be running their own businesses as well, yeah, working together, coming up with plans, but also obviously delegating, etc., when the need's there.
Exactly.
Perfect, and remembering to have fun.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And on that note, that's a great note actually to finish on, remembering to have fun. That is absolutely super. So I think Nikki covered the website and everything. Can you just repeat it actually in case anybody didn't catch it? What is the new website? If somebody goes to the old one, I can say that there are links over there that throw you onto the new one because I was on there today. But
right. If you forget and go to the old one, it'll redirect you over. But the new one is dogbizsuccess.com.
dogbizsuccess.com. Brilliant. Thank you. And thank you so much to both of you for joining us today and having that great chat. I've just sat back actually and listened, and I've learned a lot, so I'm sure as everybody else who's been listening in. So thank you, Veronica and Gina.
No, thanks for having us.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for joining us.
It's always such a pleasure.
So I'm going to go off and be my lazy dog trainer self, and you guys can
we'll do the same.
And we salute all of you non-lazy dog trainers.
Right.
We do. Okay.
Okay. Enjoy the rest of your day, everybody.